Come on, Bruce Willis, Obama, and Paris Hilton all use the same really strong password.
That's interesting.
No attacker can use these techniques that I've shown you. Grab your password and log into your Facebook and your Twitter and your YouTube.
Scary website. I mean, it's amazing to see how much data has been breached. Hey everyone, David Bumble back with Micah. Micah, welcome.
Hey, thanks, David.
So Micah, we've done a series of these videos where you show us all kinds of crazy things with OSINT. What are you gonna show us today?
Today is about breach data, about that stolen data that people have released to the internet and why we need to care about it as OSINT investigators and really just as people on the internet, because it's your and my data that's out there that other people are using.
Every other day you read about some kind of breach, some kind of hack, and I won't even mention names because, you know, by the time the video is released or whenever someone's watching this, maybe 6 months from today, it's gonna be another company. It's scary how much stuff is out there.
And it's not just scary from a perspective of me finding that as an OSINT investigator and then using it in my investigations, which is what I do professionally. But, you know, I think about my LinkedIn account, my Facebook account, my accounts on GitHub and other places, and I think if those get compromised, I may have problems. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to show you how to do some of these things that we do in the OSINT world, but then there'll also be some suggestions for you to do personally to protect yourself as well.
Please take it away. Show us what you've got.
Before this, we're going to just hit three sites. And the first is haveibeenpwned. A lot of you may not legally be able to use or view even breach data, because let's face it, breach data is stolen data. Somebody broke into a website, broke into a server, stole the user information with usernames and passwords and emails, and then released it on the internet or sold it. You wouldn't be able to use that in your investigations. But there are ways of accessing that that are more ethical and legal. And the first one is haveibeenpwned. Many, many people use this site.
Scary website. I mean, it's amazing to see how much data has been breached.
Absolutely. And just by entering in a phone number with your country code or something like an email address, you get to see the breaches that that email address or phone number were in. You don't get to see the actual data. That's the ethical and the legal part of this site. And one of the reasons why I highly recommend it. It's very simple. You just type in an email. I'm gonna use johndoe@example.com. Here for johndoe@example.com, we see 56 breaches and 12 pastes that email was found in. And if we scroll down, we see that it was in the get, the factual, the geeked in, and we can read about the other types of data that was found on these websites, and we can understand a little bit more about it. But we don't know any of the other data about this john@gmail.com. We don't know what any of the data that was in their profile, what got released. And this is actually something that scammers use all the time against us, David. I don't know if you've ever gotten the email, oh, I'm sorry to tell you, but I've had a virus on your system or a Trojan on your system for months, and I've watched you as you've gone to pornographic websites and I have videos, and then they give you a little trust trick. They say, here's your password. That password's coming from breach data. And you'd be surprised at the many people that don't realize that and actually send money.
This website is legit, right?
Oh yeah, absolutely. This website is was made by Troy Hunt, Australian security researcher, very, very trustworthy individual. And what they do is they grab the larger breaches out there. So if it has a certain number of users in that breach, they will grab it. They will then extract the email addresses and the phone numbers from the passwords. They will actually, if you go all the way up to the top here, click on the notify me link right up here and give them your email and your mother's email and your kids' emails and register them. And then when a new dump comes out and your email or somebody else's email is in there, they will email that person and say, oh, I'm really sorry, your information was in this new dump. Giving you a little bit of heads up, hopefully, before attackers get to use that.
I'll just say this, Troy's amazing. So this is a legitimate website. I only asked that question because I know a lot of people would be worried putting their telephone numbers specifically into a site like this. So it is a reputable site. Troy is doing great work. So if anyone is watching, I don't think you need to worry about putting your data in here. It's not like he's farming your data. He's trying to help you.
And David, I hate to say this, you know, people think that their emails are private. I understand in certain parts of the world, you know, there are privacy rules about storage of it and all. But the reality is if you just Google your email, your phone number, or something like that, you'll see that there are many sites out there that may be sharing that, and especially if it's found in breach data.
It depends on which generation you come from, I think, part of it. You know, in the old days, people tended to try and keep this kind of stuff private. But these days, it's so much of it's out there, it's worrying.
Absolutely. And I mean, this site, the thing I like about it is that anybody can come here and look and see, oh, yes, my email address or my target's email address was found in breaches. If you're a person that's a red teamer, somebody that's going to be doing social engineering, an OSINT investigator, what this tells me is that somebody has at some point used the John Doe@example.com email on at least 56 different websites. So it's an active-ish email address. Think about if you put in there, you know, Micah Hoffman@hotmail.com. If you were looking up me, then you could see, oh, look, Micah actually uses that. Keep in mind also that it might not be me that Micah Hoffman@hotmail.com email address maps to. So we always have to be careful of that. The thing that this site also shows you, if you go all the way to the bottom, and many, many people do not scroll to the bottom, is it gives you some of the Pastebin pastes where this email was found. And I'm just gonna click on one. I hope nothing bad comes up. You can see this is kind of like a data dump. Here we have a customer ID field. And we see as we scroll down, we have some other data, and we scroll over here, we see people's names. I wonder if I looked at this in the raw and I searched for John Doe at, there's my JohnDoe@example.com right here. So in this case, the pastes can take us to some of that raw data. And then all I have to do is parse out, hey, look, this was customer ID number 135. Here was their password right here. Oops, sorry. Here is their password. It is hashed, which is good. And maybe there's some other information here that might be useful, but you may have access to some of that raw data.
What's a paste?
So on pastebin.com and some other websites out there, it's very easy for you or me or anybody to just post information. Think of like putting a post-it note on a bulletin board in a restaurant or something like that. You know, some of the restaurants have like community boards. You can just put a notice up there. Same thing here. We can go to Pastebin, say, I want to post David Bombal's YouTube video and the link to it and submit it. And then that gets posted up there on the site until you take it down or it ages out. And that's what we're seeing here. People have used Pastebin and some other sites to paste breach data and just post it out there for anybody to find and to grab.
And they do that so that they can't be found.
They do that anonymously, right? Yeah. To release that data. And sometimes they do it also because they don't want to collaborate on a more private platform. So we've got our JohnDoe@example.com email. We found it in some breaches. Now let's say that you are one of those people who can use breach data. I have some paid services and a kind of free service for you. If we head over to intelx.io, I can just paste in JohnDoe@example.com and it shows me a bunch of redacted information. If I pay them money, then I get access to all of this data with the black lines. I'm an OSINT person, so I know that I always scroll down the page because, you know, when there's redacted data, there many times will be unredacted data as well. So what I'm doing is I'm looking for any place here that does not have, here we go. We have collection one. And you see that this is not redacted. Clicking on the link, pasting in my JohnDoe@example.com shows me that, in this collection one of old cloud gaming combos, the password associated with John Doe account was the most popular password in the world. 123456.
A lot of people who watch my videos say, I'm never going to use such a dumb password. No one's going to use passwords like that. But we both know, Micah, that people do.
Oh, absolutely. Sometimes people are just doing this as throwaway accounts. It's just like, hey, I'm just want to access that Angry Birds thing and it makes me sign up for an account. So I'm going to use JohnDoe@example.com. 123456. I don't care if somebody hijacks that account. That's what we might be seeing here. In our case, we would search and continue to go through these records and see what else came back. Here, I would note JohnDoe@example.com is associated with this password and then continue scrolling down this list and looking at other places.
Is it worth paying for this?
For me, David, I like the data on Intel X. I find that the dhash.com site, which is our next site, here you can pay by the day, by the week, or by the year, and it's a lot more affordable to buy the data here. And again, that's what we're doing, is we're buying the data from somebody else. They've collected it, made it searchable, they've indexed it, and all we're doing is using it like a search engine. One of the things that we always try to do is we do forward searches for things. We take a data point and then we do a search for that as well and see what else comes back. Let's go ahead and do this. We're going to do Obama at whitehouse.gov. So Obama at whitehouse.gov email, valid email, or at least it might have been years ago. And we can see a whole bunch of breaches or breach data that it was in. And if we click on one of these, what we see over here is any data that's associated with it. Here we can see that here the password for this one in the mmorg.net was right here, is that password. I'm hoping that it's been changed since then, but you never know. So what I'm doing is I'm looking for a certain breach because I want to show you something really cool. So what I've done is I've searched for Obama at whitehouse.gov, and on page 4 or 5 or so, I found this one for Dropbox data. And you could see that here we have the email, it was in this dump, and I've got a hashed password. Now, as an OSINT person, the easiest way for me to check what this password is, it's hashed. It's a one-way cryptographic function. I can't reverse it. I can't decrypt it. But what I can do is go to my password cracking rig. Well, at least if you're an OSINT person, this is my password cracking rig. And I put in the hash here in Google. And I see that nowhere else on the internet, none of the billions of websites have ever had this hash on their site. What this tells me is that this is probably a pretty strong or complicated password, because regular passwords like password and 123456, you'll see their password hashes up here. So here's what we've got. We've got a breach for Dropbox where somebody used this really strong password. Well, what if we could take this really strong password, paste it into the search field, and find other accounts that also use that really strong password that was hashed? And if you look here, Dropbox, Dropbox, Dropbox. So this is all probably from the same site. And we see that Polgar underscore Gino used that same password. We see Bruce Willis at Hollywood used the same password. Would it surprise you to know that Paris Hilton at Hilton.com used the same password? Come on, Bruce Willis, Obama, and Paris Hilton all use the same really strong password. So what we've probably done by doing that forward and reverse search, we've found somebody or some people that have used a very strong password on Dropbox and just signed up with random email addresses. They probably signed up for a free account with lastname@mail.com. I mean, come on, try at least, right? And then they pasted in their really strong password. Then they filled up that space, and then they signed up with Paris Hilton at Hilton.com, used that really strong password, never thinking that one day there's going to be a breach and that password or hashed password would be released. This kind of is my message to your audience. If you want to be secure, you got to plan for defeat. You got to plan for failure, and you got to plan for the fact that one day that super strong password that you use on every website is going to be released. And when it does, you better hope that it's only good on one website. So get a password manager. Use LastPass or KeePass XC or some other password manager. Use really strong passwords, but make them unique to every single website you use. So when Dropbox has a breach and your password is released, no attacker can use these techniques that I've shown you, which they use. Grab your password and log into your Facebook and your Twitter and your YouTube and take over your accounts. Because if that password is only used on one site, you've limited them.
Yeah, that's great advice. Which is your favorite password manager?
I used to use KeePass XC, which is a free open source tool. It stores things locally on my system, and I really like that. I would share those vaults via Dropbox with my other systems to synchronize my passwords. But then life got complicated, and my wife, my family needed passwords and stuff. So I've moved up to LastPass, and I use like the family plan with them, and I share passwords because we can share within our vault passwords between us, and we don't have to email them or send them via text message and take them out of that secure environment. But there are many other password managers that are out there that may be equally as good.
I'll just say this for everyone who's watching. This is not a paid advert. Neither of us are getting affiliate fees or anything for this. It's just Micah's opinion. You've shown us in previous videos that it's not the single data points that's the problem. It's when someone like you can aggregate huge amounts of data that it gets really worrying. I'll put a link below to a video where Micah was able to take data sets of someone's drinking and then like create crazy patterns of, I just thought you liked beer. Come on, Micah.
I might like beer, but I don't like telling the world. I just drank this beer at this location with these people at this date and time. And that's really what Untapped is. Untapped, you take your mobile device.
But this is a lot more serious because this is people's passwords. This is serious when someone gets hacked. So really want to thank you for, you know, sharing tips and, you know, showing us why we have to be really, really careful.
You know, I think that there are certain things in the cybersecurity and the personal security world that are really hard to implement. Using a separate password on every single site, if you have one of these password managers, is a simple thing that once you get in the habit of it, can really maximize the security aspect of it. So I'm hoping your audience takes that to heart.
How many random passwords can you make and remember? And that's why someone uses a crazy like password and uses it over and over again. It's not easy to have 100 different unique passwords.
David, I used to do cybersecurity work. And one of the things that I did for one company was every 90 days, because their password changing policy was every 90 days, their employees had to change their passwords. Yeah. And so every 90 days, I got a dump of all of their internal passwords. And my goal was not to embarrass people or whatever, but to see that password hygiene. So see how people were doing with the complex rules that this company had. There were some people that used just random letters and numbers that were really strong and secure, and I never ever cracked those passwords. But then there were some people that found ways around the rules, like using A1, 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 15 or 20 times. And then guess what? 90 days later, A2, yep. A2, yep. A2. And there were other things. People would start out with roots, like this password is for fall. Well, guess what happened when it turned yep. into winter? You know, it was really predictable. So you're absolutely right. We use these strategies, whether they're mnemonic, my kids are, you know, this person, this person, this person, and then next month you shift them around or something. We use mnemonics and we use those things that we can remember to help us, but the reality is we shouldn't be doing any of that. We should be relying on these password managers if we trust them.
Yeah, exactly. And I mean, LastPass has just had a breach recently.
Yeah, it was a breach of their development environment. And yeah. According to LastPass, they, you know, the key material, the safe material, none of it was accessed, but it can be scary. And that's why I used to use KeePass XC, which put a file on my system that somebody would have to compromise my system to get access to my vault. Depending on your personal risk tolerance, you can go ahead and do what you want, but use something. Don't come up with, you know, Micah is my favorite purple-shirted person. Although that's a secure password, you can only use that so many times.
Micah, so tell us, where can we learn more? Because you're sharing so much amazing information, but I know you've got a lot more.
I am on Twitter at WebBreacher. And also I have a class on my OSINT training site on using breach data and open source intelligence and cybersecurity types of assessments that'll teach you all of the things that I've shown you right here.
I've put links below where you can get more information. Please go and follow Micah. Please go and sign up for his classes if you're interested. Micah, thanks so much.
Thanks for having me on, David.